Hello everybody, so today we are going to make an HTTP request in Rust. How are we going to do it? Well, first thing is we're going to refer to this article here, Andrés Reales. So becomebetterprogrammer.com. The first thing to do is to create a project. If you've not done that before with Rust, then that's quite straightforward. You use cargo, new, and then name of your project. So if your project is called test project one, it goes where I've highlighted in blue. That will then generate you this tree structure with src for your source files, target, git, no, cargo.log, cargo.toml. In the toml file, so this file here, cargo.toml, we then need to, when you create it, you'll have an empty dependencies here. So what you'll need to do is come to this and just copy those two lines, paste them in, and you should get green ticks. Those green ticks means this VS Code has gone and checked those versions and checked that they're successful. If you want to follow those links, you can. And you go off to docs.rs/crate. And also you get crate reviews, and it tells you if there's negative, positive, if anybody's had problems. So two useful things there. Right, back to the code. So we are using TOKIO. Main TOKIO allows us to make asynchronous calls. Without that, you would have an error. We're going to make a request to, a get request to https catfact.ninja.fact. And this is what will be returned, hopefully, or something similar. These are kind of random quotes. So when we run it, we will get something random. This is our main code. So we're going to let a fact, which is what we're going to print out, a fact is equal to get the result of our function, which gets the cat fact. And we need to use await because we are going off to fetch something and we don't know how long it will take to get back. And we need to do that before we can then proceed to the next line, which is to print the fact. Here we use the colon, then the hash, then the question mark. That's kind of like that allows us to print in debug mode. Without that, we would get an error. So if I ran it without cargo builds, you get this error, cannot be formatted with the default formatter. So if I put that back, run it again, or compile it again even, then it should compile fine, and it has done. So let's run it. Cargo run. And it's gone off and got us a fact because we got an okay response. Cat normal temperature varies around 101 degrees Fahrenheit. Run again. Should be random. One reason the kitten sleeps so much is because its growth hormone is released only during sleep. Okay. So we have successfully got some cat facts from the API using request. So we've created within our function, our function begins on line 12. Again, prefix it with async. We use await after we've sent the request. And then whilst the text is coming back, we also use await. So it's always await with a question mark. And the dot is basically chaining the commands together. So what it's saying is once you've done this, do that, then do that, then do that. The thing which caught me was the rather lengthy response type. Now, depending on how advanced you are, you may or may not just want to copy and paste that. A box is it's what you use with when you don't know what the size will be and you want to store it on the heap rather than the stack. And you're also specifying that the result will be a string. So it's a string, and then The response will be a string, and then effectively the body will be going into this box because you don't know the actual size of it beforehand. That's my understanding of it. If anybody can describe that better, then please leave a note in the comments. So that is how to make your first request using request, R-E-Q-W-E-S-T. And don't forget to include T-O-K-I-O in your cargo.toml file. So all I've done really here is I've copied and pasted some code, I've run it, and I have edited the cargo.toml file. So obviously you can change this to suit your needs, and then from that you can then go and look at becomebetterprogrammer.com. And you can also then go on and look at serializing, deserializing the response. So if we come right down here, you can also send content type, authorization, bearer, etc. So for instance, if it was some sort of Java web tokens or OAuth going on. There we go. So thanks for watching, and I'll be back soon. Let me know in the description, sorry, the comments, if you've got any questions or suggestions or requests. R-E-Q-U-E-S-T-S. Thanks for watching. I'll be back soon. Thank you.